Topical questions. And our first question today is from Ian Gray, who joins us remotely. Ian Gray.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had regarding planned industrial action by college staff this week.
Thank you. Minister Richard Lockhead.
My most recent discussions were with Colleges Scotland yesterday to discuss the latest round of negotiations, which are taking place as we speak. My officials have been in regular contact with them also to ensure I have been kept up to date with all these negotiations. I understand that as part of these discussions, the EIS FILA union has accepted that there is no national plan to replace lecturers with tutors, assessors or instructor roles, nor any other support staff roles. And I would therefore encourage both the employers and unions to continue with the current negotiations in an attempt to resolve this situation without the need for industrial action, which is absolutely not in the best interests of our learners, especially at this time against the backdrop of the pandemic.
Thank you. Ian Gray.
Indeed, with students trying to maintain their studies in spite of the pandemic, clearly strike action in colleges is undesirable, and in this case, it's unnecessary. Equally, this is no time to attack the terms and conditions. College staff, the fact is that over a week ago, the National Joint Negotiating Committee agreed the principle that there is no national plan to replace lecturers with instructor-type posts doing the same job, and then EIS FILA, the trade union, ratified this agreement in its national executive and suspended action. But Colleges Scotland refused to do so, even although the agreement was based on an employer-side proposal. This just seems a matter of bad faith. Will the Minister intervene now and ask College Scotland to stand by their own words, ratify the agreement they made, and stop the need for strike action?
Minister.
As Ian Gray knows, this is a matter to be resolved between the employers and the trade unions. And much progress has been made over the last few weeks and months with the joint statement, which you're aware of, I'm sure, where, as I said in my opening answer, they have agreed there is no national plan to replace lecturers with these other roles. However, as part of that statement, clearly there was disagreement over a separate part in relation to the responsibilities that make up the definition of a lecturer. As the negotiations are ongoing, I do hope they make constructive progress today, which will lead to an agreement and therefore calling off the strike that's planned for later this week, which, as I think we all agree, and Ian Gray has agreed with, is unnecessary and also is not in the interest of learners at this time against the backdrop of the pandemic.
Ian Gray.
I appreciate the Minister's desire to avoid strike action, but the fact of the matter is an agreement on all points was reached in the negotiating committee. The trade union side have ratified that agreement. It is the employer side who have reneged on it and refused to ratify it. Does the Minister not think that he really should speak to Colleges Scotland, ensure that they ratify the agreement they made, and end college staff's fear of an attack on terms and conditions and the need to strike?
Minister.
As I explained to Ian Gray, I did speak to Colleges Scotland, indeed just yesterday evening, about this, and encouraging Colleges Scotland, as indeed I encourage the trade union, to reach an agreement and call off the strike action. These are staffing matters between the employer and the representatives of the employee. And of course, as Ian Gray says, the employer did not ratify the joint statement. And I do hope they can settle their differences at today's negotiations, which were taking place this morning, and then adjourned and then reconvened this afternoon, in order that we can avoid strike action, which is in no one's interest, and most of all, not in the interest of our learners.
Jamie Green to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst we all want to avoid industrial action, we cannot ignore the fact that the sector has seen real terms funding cuts of £80 million since 2008, which clearly is forcing colleges to consider restructuring as cost-saving exercises. Can the Minister accept that these cuts have put tremendous pressures on our college sector and that we must do everything we can now to support them in light of the vital role they will play in post-COVID recovery?
Minister.
Can I just say to Jamie Green that the college's budget has increased by 30% since this government came into office in 2007, and indeed the most recent budget settlement was actually welcomed by stakeholders, plus the one-off COVID consequentials as well. But yes, things are tough for Further Higher Education at the moment, largely as a result, as he's aware, of the pandemic, and therefore that's another reason why hopefully both sides can reach an agreement today and call off strike action later this week. I'm sure they do want to do that, and I hope they'll just stay in the negotiating room today until they reach a settlement.
Ross Greer.
Thank you. Can I suggest to the Minister that strike action is in the interest of college lecturers if it saves their job? Of course, no one wants it to come to that. This has essentially become an annual event where the union representing lecturers believe an agreement has been reached in good faith, only for management to go back on it and the situation to have to escalate to industrial action or the threat thereof. Does the fact that this happens on an annual cycle not raise serious questions about college management's ability to negotiate in good faith?
Minister.
Ross Greer may be interested in the latest statistics that were published today that shows that the number of full-time permanent college teaching staff with a recognised teaching qualification in Scotland's colleges actually increased by 2.1 percentage points in the last year for which these figures are available. So there's actually an increase in the number of staff in our colleges with these qualifications. I absolutely want both sides to reach an agreement today. That's in the interests of our colleges and employees and most of all of learners as well. We are talking, of course, about one particular dispute between one union and the college employers, and depending on the outcome of today's negotiations, that could indeed affect other unions as well. So therefore, we have to pay close attention to this. I absolutely accept that. But the responsibility is between the employers and the employees to reach an agreement today.
Thank you. Moving on to our second topical, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how the regulation of Moss Moran ethylene plant will change following the independent review.
Cabinet Secretary Rosanna Cunningham.
As the member is aware, SEPA published the outcome of the Irish Environment Protection Agency peer review of its regulatory approach at Moss Moran on Friday 19th March. SEPA and indeed the Scottish Government is clear that compliance with Scotland's environmental laws is non-negotiable. SEPA has published a detailed response to all 20 recommendations made by the review, which covered technical site recommendations, regulatory approach, community liaison, communications, monitoring and modelling. And key recommendations which will be taken forward by SEPA include extending the environmental monitoring programme with community participation in its design, enhanced visibility of regulatory monitoring results and investment in a refreshed online community information hub. SEPA already has specialist staff involved in work at Moss Moran and in response to this peer review has committed to further strengthen regulation and monitoring across the forthcoming investment period at the site.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. After 5 years of highlighting the misery of communities living in the shadow of Moss Moran, can I welcome the progress that has now been made and also pay tribute to local campaigners who've kept the pressure on SEPA and the plant operators? Many of the 1,500 people who complained to SEPA last year did so because they couldn't sleep for days on end due to noise pollution. Will the Cabinet Secretary urge SEPA to set revised noise limits as part of the operator's permit and to expand noise monitoring in the community?
First Minister.
Well, I'm glad that Mark Ruskell considers there to have been progress. I believe that there has been a very great deal of progress. I pointed to the 20 recommendations of that independent evaluation. SEPA has already accepted 8. 9 are currently underway. That's 9 more are currently underway. 1 will be considered and 2 are not being taken forward. I think there is already specialist monitoring, compliance, enforcement and support staff involved in all work at Moss Moran. And in response to the peer review, SEPA has committed to further strengthening regulation and monitoring across the investment period, as I indicated. So the issue that is raised by Mark Ruskell will be included in part of that consideration.
Thank you very much, Mark Ruskell.
Can I welcome that response? And, you know, while the regulatory improvements are welcome, Moss Moran still remains Scotland's third largest climate polluter, and it will be impossible for us to meet climate targets without serious and urgent action at the plant. Will the Scottish Government take the word of ExxonMobil, an organisation responsible for climate denial when it comes to future plans for Moss Moran, or will the Government itself lead the discussion with the operators and the community on what a just transition for the plant should look like?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there is a constant discussion both within government and between government and a variety of different partners, and that includes sectors of the economy as to how this goes forward. We are tasking individual companies to be looking very carefully at their own proposals in respect of just transition, and the same task is being suggested to ExxonMobil, with whom I have had recent correspondence, as the member is aware. So just transition is an absolutely vital part of what we do in terms of taking forward the work that we need to do over the next 10 years to get to our interim targets. And Moss Morin as well will be very much a part of that just transition discussion.
Thank you. Annabel Ewing, to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Irish EPA's recommendations on enhanced air quality monitoring and wider community engagement are very welcome indeed. And in fact, are matters I have been calling for many years. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that these recommendations will be implemented at pace? And can the Cabinet Secretary also confirm that the Scottish Government will make it quite clear to the operators of the site that the flaring, which is apparently to result from the need to shut down the plant in the weeks ahead to go ahead with upgrade works, that flaring will be kept to the bare minimum to ensure that the least disruption to affected communities is caused? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I know this is an issue that the member has been closely involved with for some time, and I do value her constructive engagement on the matter. Of the 20 recommendations from the peer review, as I've indicated, 9 are already underway and a further 8 have been accepted by SEPA. Those already being taken forward do include recommendations relating specifically to air quality monitoring and community engagement. SEPA is finalising a project plan to take forward implementation of the other recommendations, including work around communications, monitoring of volatile organic compounds and modelling. On flaring, SEPA has been very clear that this was unacceptable and must become the exception rather than the routine. And the Scottish Government has and will continue to impress upon the operators the need to minimise disruptive flaring during the forthcoming shutdown and restart process. The forthcoming £140 million investment in the site should improve reliability. Unplanned elevated flaring and its associated impact on the local community should become a less frequent occurrence, and when flaring is required, its impact should be reduced. And this is the basis on which we are having conversations with ExxonMobil.
And Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. SEPA have indicated that the plant now has a clear pathway to compliance. But the community is still sceptical after years of disruption and misery caused by failures and flaring. Therefore, what assurances can the Cabinet Secretary give to local residents when SEPA have rejected proposals to install a suitably qualified and experienced expert at the site to ensure compliance and monitoring progress on the day-to-day installation of the new low-noise flare tip?
Cabinet Secretary.
Alexander Stewart is referring to one of the two recommendations that SEPA is not taking forward, and that the one is in relation to having a dedicated site agent. But the fact is that SEPA already dedicates significant resources to Moss Morin, more than to any other single regulated site in Scotland. SEPA also gains additional expertise by working with partners such as HSE and by bringing in specialist technical expertise if or when needed. The site agent recommendation isn't being pursued. While SEPA can see that there may be benefit in deploying a site agent at other types of sites, SEPA don't consider it would add value to Moss Morin. And SEPA currently reviews permits in line with the process set out in the Pollution Prevention and Control Scotland Regulations 2012. They'll assess its supporting guidance to ensure it is clear what criteria it uses to decide when a permit review is required. But at this point, it does not consider a dedicated site agent is a necessary or appropriate response.
Thank you very much. And that concludes topical questions. Before we move on to the next item of business, could you just encourage all members, if the guidance is to use or to remain in the same seat if you're coming in out of the chamber, if you do change seats, please use the wipes available to wipe down the desk and chair beforehand. We're going to move on now to